possession shows up, trash is soon to follow. As I said to you a while ago, a huge environmental issue. I've talked to Jimmy about trash-free trekking. How can they not use the water bottles, the little sanitary things that you clean yourself off when you arrive, the paper napkins at supper, and individual packets of tea and coffee that they give you at meals? How, Jimmy, can you introduce trash-free trekking here? So in 2 years, I'm going to go back and see if he's made progress. Now, this is not what's going on here, but I forgot I was going to tell you that about Jimmy, our trekking guy, that he can think about doing this trash-free. Plus, it'll be less expensive. Anyway, so there's down by the rivers. Oh, boy. So down we go, down to the Delta area where it's very flat. You can see how the tides rise and fall there. Even if it's 15 miles from the ocean, you still get the tides rise and fall. And then, this is where they're growing their rice. This is where their rice production areas are. So they say global sea levels have risen about 6 inches so far. They say by the end of the century, it could be 6 feet. What's going to happen to the rice-producing regions of Burma? It's going to be a slow-motion catastrophe, humanitarian catastrophe. So again, we're causing things around the world that are coming back on people that they don't really deserve, you might say. And then putting in shrimp farms, cutting down the mangrove swamps, and all of you know the economic services of mangrove swamps. They're cutting down mangrove swamps to put in the shrimp plantations down in the coastal areas of Myanmar and every other place around South Asia. And so you don't have those anymore. But one thing they do, if you've got a typhoon, or a tsunami coming at you, they'll take the wave energy out of that stuff, like 75% of the wave energy out of those things that are coming at you. So you don't have those there anymore. You've got the mangrove swamps. There's a mangrove swamp cut down to make way for them. Then you've got something like Cyclone Nargis 8 years ago. The winds were 150 miles an hour. Killed 135,000 people in one night. It was like the angel of death. So you've got higher sea levels, which gives these storms a better launching pad. You've got warmer water, warmer atmosphere, which makes the storms more violent. Then you cut down the mangrove swamps, which lack the protective zone. And then the people are living in straw houses anyway, and poof, there it went. We were there actually just a couple months after this. These women, with 10 of their friends, clung to that palm tree for 11 hours to escape a 12-foot storm surge. Half their village was killed. A lot of orphans and children whose families are too poor after the storm. We're giving scholarships to all these girls to keep them in school after the storm. We're going out to see some things. I had to tell you this story. This isn't so related to the environmental piece, but I just want to tell you this story. Women, and especially women in the poor communities in Myanmar, have two choices typically. Stay in the village and stay poor, or go to the cities and work in the sweatshops or the karaoke bars. Those seem to be the two kind of options. So these women have been telling us about this. So there's a sweatshop where these women started off making 11 cents an hour. When the country started opening up to outside business after the military guys were out of power about 5 years ago, the corporations came in paying these women 11 cents. They protested, got 35 cents now, which made them have to produce more stuff because they're getting so much money. Anyway, so one option is go there and make 35 cents an hour, working and getting harassed while you're doing it, or be sent around the region as a maid, a household servant. So these young women in the Delta area of Myanmar, those are two ready available options, and they call it migration. You're migrating out of the village to go to the cities or to another country even to be a maid. Well, in this case, and the one causal factor of this is they can't afford to send their kids beyond fifth grade. Because they go to fifth grade, there's a bunch of fifth graders. Beyond fifth grade, you've got to take the boat bus. It costs $6 a month to go to the next village to middle school. People could not afford this. So we got these projects going with the women. We give them microloans, a little pool of money to the women. They divide it up among themselves, start small businesses, pay back the loan. They loan it out to the next group of women. They start called small businesses, pay it back, and then they're kind of increasing their economic capability. So things like the fish thing there. These women started a betel leaf project, which is mean it's a little wrapping that you wrap tobacco, some sort of a nut, and then some wine in. You put a pinch between your cheek and gum, it makes your teeth red, that's all I know. A mild stimulant, which keeps people addicted. And so anyway, they sell this stuff. They're making $1.25 an hour. Over three times as much as a sweatshop wage. And they can stay in their own villages. The women told us directly, the young women from here do not have to migrate now. They can stay in our villages. So I want to say there's another option. For women staying in the village and staying poor, and having to go to work in the sweatshops or the karaoke bars where they're abused, they can stay in their own villages if they have the opportunity. So that's kind of how we're trying to work with this. So there's the beetle leaf production. So these women are keeping their daughters in school. There's a mother and daughter. There's a mother and daughter. They can keep the girls in school now. These are all girls that have gone on to middle school and high school because their mother's now earning some money. That's just an aside. Oh, And they said our family life is happier. Because now the husbands don't have to do all the work and earn all the money. They can spend more time with the family. Who would have thought? And this never crossed my mind as an objective of this program. But that's what's been an outcome. So kind of cool. I thought you'd like that. Just threw it in. Here's after the cyclone. Wiped the place clean of trees. We were there 18 months after. We were there 3 months after. And we were there 18 months after. This is 18 months after along the coastal area. Wiped the place clean of trees. It looked like a barren wasteland. It was hot. It was dry. Then they used some of our money to replant. There we go. And there's Julian from Lycoming. She was at Green Allies last time, not this time, the time before. Anyway, she got involved with our programs. She went to Myanmar with us. There's Grant from Illinois. Anyway, so there's like a virtual forest that came back just a few years later after some reforestation. So it kind of just restored the area, sort of spiritually, I want to say, in terms of the feeling of the place. But also, eucalyptus is good for lumber and other stuff too, that they can use eventually if they want to. So kind of a nice switch, kind of a nice switch. Bye-bye Myanmar, hello Navajo Reservation. By the way, we call it Navajo, they call themselves the Diné. So we're going to go with Diné. Well, the Diné Reservation in New Mexico. This is Calvin. He was sent away to a boarding school when he was a grade school kid. If you spoke a word of your language, they put a bar soap in your mouth. In the 1970s, this wasn't that long ago, an Indian boarding school. And here, you know, I'm thinking, part of our philosophy in our organization, we need to be learning from Native groups how they lived here. Here, the here, or the Amazon, or any place else, because they know how to live here. And here, we're sticking a bar of soap in their mouth if they talk their native language, which is the opposite of what I think we need to be doing with the natives. Anyway, there's Calvin and his mother. We were actually helping do some housing refurbishment. There's a girl from Pennsylvania. She goes to a college. I can't remember which one. Anyway, there's a girl from Claremont, California, a boy from Missouri right there. There we are helping Grandma Rose get a hogan. And they call New Mexico the land of enchantment. And it is kind of, it's beautiful. We had some nice natural experiences, but I was out there again about 2 months, or really a month ago right now. I was in New Mexico after our trip, and all this has happened since then. The fracking industry is moving in. You know what I'm talking about, Pennsylvania? You know what I'm talking about, fracking? Busting up the stuff underground and release the hydrocarbons out. Anyway, there's this stuff. They got the big refineries going on, the huge trucks on the dirt roads. Then they had an explosion. Last time we were there, they had an explosion. We actually got to see this happen of the oil tanks that were there. And all out in New Mexico on what is kind of Navajo territory. The government owns a lot of it. That's what's happening. So they rent it out to the oil companies all around the Navajo Reservation or the Diné Reservation. Halliburton, they make billions on all this. They make billions off the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. They make billions off the Amazon oil extraction. They're making millions off the stuff going on in the Southwest. Whoops. And so, they're, you know, these native communities, the Chaco culture, they lived there for generations, for thousands of years, without messing everything up. What can we learn from them? How did they do it that we could do it, that we could learn some things from them? So that's part of the goal of our organization, is try to figure some of that out. And they're fighting back. The native communities are fighting back. Young people are fighting back. There's a young woman, a little older than some of you, who's now dedicating her life to speaking up against the fracking that's going on. We're going to give her some money, some spending money, a few $100 a month, but she doesn't really have a job because she's invested herself in this other world. So we're going to help her have a little money to kind of live while she's doing this fighting for her people and for the environment out there. Her name is it may come. So that's what we do. Here's our sustainable centers I've told you a little bit about. We have garden stuff, but this is the one up in Vermont. They need a volunteer this summer, by the way, an intern up there. This is the Congolese refugee family. We're helping start gardens down in Harrisonburg, Virginia. We're helping people that are addicted and abused and everything else kind of get their lives back in the soil, because there's healing, you know, in the soil. Helping them learn to do gardening and stuff. We do bicycle advocacy. We do climate change stuff. We had, during the Standing Rock Sioux protests, we had a mobile teepee in Harrisonburg, moving around town, educating people about what was going on in the Dakotas and talking about climate change connections there in their little town in Virginia. So we do that kind of stuff. We take stuff to the city council in these communities. We get a chicken ordinance. You couldn't have chickens in the poultry capital of the world, Harrisonburg, Virginia, because the poultry industry didn't want diseases coming in with stray chickens. So they eventually took the kids to the city council meeting, the fifth graders. And they spoke to the kids, and it was hard for the city council to say, they don't shut up to the kids. And finally, they got permission to have chickens in your backyard, stay a block away from poultry factories. Yeah, that's okay. And otherwise, you can have chickens. So they're working at the systemic changes, not just what we're doing on our small site, but how they're also now working at putting orchards all around the town. Carbon sequestration, fresh food, places of kind of beauty and wonder. They're going to have like they're going to actually start an orchard run by homeless people and other poor people onto community property, and then use that to be a nursery to send fruit trees all around the community. So they're trying to kind of restore things in their community, including the chickens. There's our genius down there. I, you know, he wouldn't want me calling him this, but he knows more about how this world works and how we need to work with it than anybody I've ever met. Tom Benevento, Master's in Sustainable Development, and then he's been doing it his whole life. And if you go work with us up in Vermont, you get to stay in the, how do you call it? The round thing that's got the who knows, what's it called?
I have one, but I
forgot
the name. A yurt.
Yurt, that's it. Thank you. You get to stay in your yurt, and you have your own private bathroom.
Definitely.
Uh-huh. We're taking care of you up there. Oh, yeah. So that's what we're trying to do. We're just trying to build this new community with people and with the planet. Now, we don't see people or planet as resources, but we see them as relationships. So what can we do to move this thing that direction? Tell me some things that we need to start doing to begin moving this thing. What are the different levels? Let's start with, here's what I want to ask you. What are the obstacles that stand in our way? I'm going to write these on the board. My handwriting's not that great, but you'll know what I'm writing. So what are the obstacles? If we want to move to this other way, what's one obstacle?
Education.
So education of people is one. So educate is an obstacle because people aren't educated. How do we do that? What's one? Government is an obstacle. It sure can be. The government has its own vested interest in things, not always our vested interest. Other obstacles that stand in the way. Yes?
Apathy
is a huge one. So apathy of people who don't seem to care. I don't know if this will go up, Miranda. Can we get this to go up? Then people can see here. I'm sorry, I could probably do it, but I'm afraid I'll mess it up. So apathy is another one. What's another one? Yes, in the back.
Big business.
Say it again?
Big business.
They've got a stake in a lot of things, and so that can be an issue for them. That can be an obstacle in our way. Yes. So big business, government, education, apathy. What else? Who's got another one? Other obstacles in our way if we want to kind of get this thing headed in a new direction. Anyone else got anything? Those are some great ones. Now you have to come up with the antidotes to each of these. So let's talk about the antidotes to each of you. Yes, sir.
I was going
to
say also like scientific advancement, like with renewable fuels.
You know that? Like so you're saying that's an obstacle, that we're not getting enough of that's kind of what you're saying.
We're not quite there yet.
We aren't quite there yet. So the scientific advancement is not as far along as we wish it would be, and it's going to seem to be less prioritized right now in our country anyway. So scientific advancement hasn't gone as far as we want it to be. So let's start at the top. Well, yes, you have another one, you have an antidote.
Yeah, I was just going to say a lot of the things that people probably need to do is going to take a lot of time, more time and money than they have to do. So it has to be easier and it has to be cheaper.
Okay. So, okay, fine. All right, so it has to be easier and simpler for them to do if or else they're not going to do it. Is that kind of what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, like us, someone who, works all the time and stuff.
Yes, okay, yes. We're busy, we're distracted, yes. And of course we gotta work more because we're buying all the stuff because we can't make it ourselves, but yes.
Yeah.
Yes, so we're busy. I'm gonna put busy. That's terrific, I'm gonna put it right here actually. We're busy, we're distracted, we're occupied. It's gotta be simple. Yeah, it's gotta be simple, clear to us, convenient for us, all those things. That's really good. What else? Any other obstacles you wanna get before we go to the antidotes? Any other obstacles you see before we go to the antidotes? It hasn't directly started to hurt us so much yet. I mean, the things we're doing, we've been talking about them, we know they're happening in the world. It really hasn't come back on us yet. It's starting to come back on creatures and the rainforest and poor people and, through climate change and other stuff, but it really hasn't started to hurt us yet. So I'm going to say, so far to this point, there's not a lot of self-interest involved. You see what I'm saying? We don't see why it's in our interest to make these changes. So I'm going to put that up here as another one. So we're lacking a sense of self-interest. Self-interest because of the reason I just said to you. Okay, let's start with the antidotes. So let's start with apathy, though. What's the cure to apathy? Give me some ideas for how you work with apathy. How do you work with apathy? Who's got an idea? in your own experience, yes?
I mean, like, images can be very powerful.
Images can be powerful, yeah. So pictures, stories, word images, mind images, those things can be powerful. Okay, so good. So part of our solution there are images of various kinds. You're humanizing, you're personalizing, you're visceralizing. I just made that up, but you know what I'm saying. You're doing that. You're making things visceral to people. Say more.
Like, just sort of communicating with people and understanding, like, this is a problem to them and why it's a problem to them.
Okay, you mean people who are these people?
Who are suffering from.
Okay, so so one thing that wakes us up is finding people, or we might say environmental places, that are suffering, and you have an encounter with that. You see that what's really happening there. So, personal engagement of the problem. That's what you're saying. Is that kind of what you're saying? Personal engagement of the problem. Yes, I think that's critical. That's why we take the learning tours. That's why we have people come to the Sustainable Living Center. That's why I come and do my song and dance, so that people have a sense of being close and personal with the issue and the people that are struggling or the creatures that are struggling. So you're making it personal. That's very good. What else? Anything else with the apathy thing? Anything else with the apathy thing?
I think that you have a lot of power, like a person has a lot of power within your own circle. Mm-hmm.
You have a lot of power within your own circle or your family or friends, she's saying. And that can be a slow process, as we all know, but that is your reference group, and they do respect. In fact, somebody did a book on this about 10 years ago. Oh, wish I could remember the name. But it said that each of us has about 10 other people that look to us. It talked about leaders in communities, and most of you are leaders in your communities, that there's at least 10 other people looking to you for how to shape their own opinions. So take the power that's yours. And you don't have to beat them over the head with it. But you're being who you are, but being constant about who you are. You're being constant about it so that they can see that reflected, and you talk about it too. So, yes, what were we saying? So, your circle. So I'm just going to say, your circle, you have power in your circle. Yeah, you have power in your circle. All right, anything else about the apathy thing? Anything to get people off the apathy square that you can think of? That's some great ideas right there. And we try to use some of those in our organization, as I said to you. Let's go to educate. What's the keys to education? What's the keys to education? I've got loads of brochures. What's the keys to education? If you want to educate, how are you going to do this? Yes.
Priority could be put on it.
Yes, there's a priority you put on it. Yes, and how are you going to educate others? You mean a priority you put on educating others? What do you mean?
I mean like schools putting more, like public schooling, like putting more.
Okay, that's great. So institutionally, those sort of educational experiences have that more as a priority. They put that up at the upper echelon, upper level someplace. So elevating education on the priority list, that is very good. Who's got another one? For the education thing, what's the secret to educating people? They can so easily turn you off on some of this stuff. Is there any secret to quote educating people? Yes. That's a hard one to pull off because you care about these things, and yet you don't want to be beating somebody about it or making them feel bad necessarily, although we all should feel bad. But we feel bad too. That's another thing we say is, I've got my issues too. I drove up here in a rental car. I've got my issues too. And so how do we share the information, letting them know that we're all working on this? I mean, that's why I like to think of how we try to put it. We try to put the problem out here. How are we going to solve this problem? It's not your problem, because it's my problem too. So how can we work together on this thing that we've got? We had friends down in Warrensburg, Missouri, who wanted to get bike lanes. It's a college town. It's a university town, but there were no bike lanes. So they went to the city council. The first time, the guys just sat there just like this. Well, they kept going back. And they brought information. They brought education. They talked about cost analysis. They did all this stuff. They never badgered or beleaguered or belittled those council people. They treated them respectfully. By the time it was all over, I want to say a year and a half later, they were ready to put bike lanes installed, and the city council guy who first sat there like that said, call me if you need more paint. That's what the guy said. Call me if you need more paint. So, you know, people can come around if they're treated, if you go the education thing in the right way. Yeah. Okay, let's go to another one. How about government? That's the one we put up here next. Is there anything we can do? I keep writing my congressperson in Virginia. He writes me back these form letters like he never heard of anything I said. And he won't come to county meeting. They have to put a cardboard cutup of this guy to pretend like they're having a meeting with him. This is one of our congresspeople in Virginia. So what do you suggest about the government? Is there anything we can do about the government? Yes.
I think that goes off of educating people.
Okay.
Just because when generally government only really cares about whether or not they're going to get elected.
She's hoping that we'll affect enough people with our educational policies that it'll affect the people that are getting elected. That's certainly the long end game right there. How do you get enough popular education that the government can't stand in the way anymore? That's certainly one approach. So we work down here. Anything else you want to say about government, though? Should you be in the government? There's a guy, one of the guys who organized the Occupy Wall Street movement, what, 5 years ago now? He was actually one of the principal organizers. They interviewed him on Weekend Edition or something, 2 or 3 weeks ago, some of you may have heard him on National Public Radio. The guy said, you know, that really didn't work. Look who we got running the government now. We got Wall Street running the government. I mean, that was sort of what he was saying. That it really didn't work. What we need to do now is get ourselves elected to local city councils and stuff. Now, I'm not sure that there was a lot of consciousness raising going on through that. Education was going on through that whole Occupy process. But I think for him thinking effectiveness, we didn't really change anything. Now, again, I'm not against us being out in the streets. I think there's the women's margin. There's valuable things here. But he's also saying, and he didn't get elected. He tried. He failed. So there's, you know, electing is not a pure path. And once you get there, politics is compromise. But not to say we don't need some people balancing the compromise on this side when you've got other people balancing it on this side. You see what I'm saying? Then at least you're pulling it back in this direction a little ways. So, and Gernot Wagner, a guy who wrote a book called But Will the Planet Notice, said you and me, people like you and me in your college, you're doing clean principles, you're recycling everything, you're planting your own tomatoes, you're doing all this stuff. He said it won't matter if 7 billion people are headed the other direction. He said you have to work within government structures. Well, to a point, I sort of agree with him. You have to figure out a way to, that's one approach. One approach is the grassroots thing, like you're speaking up, and maybe like the Occupy guy, actually try to get yourself elected to these things, and then you're on the council with a vote. A voice. You might not, vote might not carry the day, but you've got a voice there. So maybe that's one thing. So two different ways the government thing. The people in trying to maybe actually, our friends down in Harrisonburg, Virginia, they now have a, they're going to have a town manager or some, no, that's not the right word. They have a town manager. They're going to get a process involved where everything the council decides in terms of building projects and regulations, they have to run it through kind of a sustainability director, kind of like you, sort of. Well, you know what I'm saying. I didn't mean to give you too much credit, but your office. Can that work? Your office. So in the city, they're going to have to run it through like a sustain, and they got 8 of their people elected to that thing, appointed to it. They stacked the deck. So, you know, they're working within the system to get their voice heard. But, you know. Anyway, okay, next. Well, big business. Any secrets here? Any strategies here? How do you want to affect the people with the big bucks and the big organizational operations? Yeah?
With education, change people's preferences.
Okay, so start at the bottom, just change people's consumer preferences. That's a long, slow grade, but boy, it could be effective if it works. And boycotts occasionally have positive, at least the bad press gets people, you know, thinking, corporation thinking. So, yes, working the popular level. What else? Anything else with corporations you would say? Some people think you ought to be on their boards. You ought to buy some stock and be on their boards. I don't know. Some people do that. That's one way some people get involved. They buy stock and that way they get a vote. I don't know, maybe. So that's a way, this is a way, you know, if we had government regulations that said if you're fouling the streams and you're dumping your coal waste down in the streams below, that's going to cost you and be penalized, that would also affect big business. We're not doing that right now. But we could. We could. So government regulation, you and me from the popular approach, those are two other ways. Let's see, we've got, what does this next one say?
Oh, is that the scientific advance?
Scientific advance, so we need to certainly turn our country toward more investment in these sort of progressive technologies, which doesn't seem to be in the favor right now, but that's certainly a direction we need to go. And we need all of your good minds working on this stuff as you come out of a place like this. Yes. Oh, these guys. Hey, you guys. Woo-hoo. Excuse me. Anybody out here? Right. Don't leave home without this. Me and the rest of you. Just walk right down here. I don't care. So, we're going to skip the signs in. We're going to busy. What's the solution to busy? Distracted. Too occupied. Too many soccer practices. What's the solution to this?
Changing your habits so, like, at a certain point you don't have to think about it as much, becomes part of your routine.
Okay, so part of it's that. Yes, you build a different kind of routine. Yes.
You can get really overwhelmed by, like, all of the bad things that, like, you can contribute to, but maybe just, like, taking one at a time.
Okay, so focus in on an achievable thing, one step. That's a really good process, yes.
Like, making a schedule and trying to fit in.
So make your schedule, try to fit into these specific things. She said take one at a time so you don't get overwhelmed. Yes.
Going off what Kyle said, I feel like a lot of it is just changing littler things. So like you said about the guy who like three paper towels.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
That's just kind of like what people do, but you don't actually need to do that.
And one thing will lead to another thing. Yes, you don't really need to do that. And I actually was in a restaurant with a friend of mine. We went to eat together. He took me out someplace. We were in a long story. Anyways. He just automatically went to the thing and did that, and then he looked at me and said, oh, you don't do that, do you? So, you know, he realized, and so it was a moment for him to think about this stuff, but he's never had to think about this stuff. We don't, none of us have to think about this stuff. We live in America. We almost take it as a human right that we don't have to think about this stuff, which is a whole other issue, our sense of entitlement. What am I also going to say about this, though? The busyness. Oh, at our place in Virginia, they got a lot of work to do. And in Vermont, they got a lot of work to do. They take a Monday morning time where they just sort of get themselves centered. They slow down, they all talk, they do some reflection on things, they plan their week a little bit, but they're also just reflecting on life and spirituality and all that stuff. So they're pausing away from the busyness and saying there's more to life than this. So that's part of it too. Don't get so caught up that we don't have a sense that there's other things in life that are important. And there's another routine that can be just as rewarding as getting a Big Mac. And what's the first one say? Self-interest. So, you know, we have to make it pay to do the good things and not to do the bad things. And that's a big problem. It would take a shift in our way we organize our lives as an economy and as the global economy to make it in our self-interest. But it'll come back on us one of these days, but by then, you know, it's going to be hard to stop it if you wait for it to be that long. It's like when I'm making peanut butter toast in my old toaster oven. If you start to smell it burning, it's already too late. You know what I'm saying here? And I feel that about the global climate, for instance. Once we start to smell it burning, it's probably going to be too late. So there's a guy, a man who sat by the gate of a village. And the people would bring their problems to this man. He was considered the wise one, you know, the sage of the community. People bring all the problems to them, but he always seemed to know the right thing to say. So there was a young guy who was in the village who sort of resented all the respect that the old guy got, and he thought he could show him up to be sort of foolish rather than a wise man. So he had a plan. He thought to himself, I'll catch a small bird. I'll put it in my hands. I'll go to the village gate where the old man is, and I'll wait my turn, and I'll pay my respects, and then I'll say to the old man, old man, we all know you're wise here, and you always know the right thing to say. This bird in my hands, is it alive or is it dead? And he thought to himself, if the old man says the bird is alive, I'll crush it. Open my hands to show the bird dead and the old man to be a fool. If the old man says the bird is dead, I'll open my hands, the bird will fly away. Again, the old man shown to be a fool. So the day came and the young man caught the little bird. The man was sitting by the village gate, all the people were gathered around. He went and with the bird in hand, up to the old man and waited his turn there, and then finally said to the old man, old man, we all respect you deeply here in this village. We always know you know what the right thing is to say, and so do I. I also respect you deeply. Tell me, old man, this bird in my hands, is it alive or is it dead? The old man looked down at the boy's hands and looked up into the boy's eyes and said, young man, the bird is in your hands. For whatever reason, this bird is in our hands. This beautiful, bountiful, endangered, but resilient environment is in our hands. And so I want to thank you for the way that you are handling it with care. I'm trying to share that important message to the people around you. That's it. Nice to see everyone. So I'm here, I've got nothing better to do for a little while. I've got a have some place to spend the night, so if you're out, help yourself to stuff down here. If you want to chat on more, I'm happy to talk individually or however. But thank you all so much for coming. If you're not on the mailing list, I'd love to have you here. We often inundate you with stuff. Try to keep you posted on things that are interesting, maybe to you, and you might connect with us. The purple sheet has ways to connect with us very clearly. So, and here's our host. Yes?
Yes. Here's some stuff for you. Thank you so much for coming.
Seriously?
Made a card.
Oh, man.
Out of some of the old.
That is sweet. This is going right in my house, right on the place. I've got a place for it.
Got some swag.
No, man.
Brought it in a reusable bag. Yeah, they were like, okay, do you want a plastic bag? I'm like, no, just take this one.
Job. Nice job, man.
Got you a hat there.
Never had one of these babies, that's for sure. Oh, yeah.
Sure.
The bag's mine too?
Yeah, the bag's yours.
It's perfect for bicycling. It's lightweight. You can't imagine how much produce I can stuff in that thing. It's so serious. Plus, it's easily washable. Oh, man. Oh, man. Plus, I'll be giving you free promo all the way down the road. Well, thank you so much. Beautiful shirt, too. One of my favorite colors, also. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, gorgeous. Gorgeous. Thank you, man. Thank you, man.
Thank you so much.
Thank all of you all. Well, keep up the good work here. That's all I can say to you. We're in this together. It feels so good to me to come to a place like this. It's encouraging to me. I mean, it's depressing the things we talk about, of course. But it's so encouraging to know you want to speak about these things, because a lot of people don't want to talk about this. They don't want to even acknowledge it. So the fact that you're willing to come out on a nice evening, spend an hour and 23 minutes with us talking about this stuff, it says a lot about the possibilities. It says a lot about the possibilities. Yeah, so I'll hang around. If anybody wants to chat about anything else, I'm here. Otherwise, I don't want to hold some of you up. They have other things to do, so thanks, crowd. And sign up again if you want to pick up stuff that you really like.
Oh, I think I forgot to mention earlier, but the event was sponsored by Lee.
Yeah. You're right, Lee. Learning tours coming up, kids. Love to see you on one of our trips with us. We'll see this stuff up close and personal. Sustainable centers. Get out of